So you're not getting it. You can try. Yes. They are. And then another group. Who is it?
Middle
Eastern. Huh? Middle Eastern
group.
Yeah. Terrorism more? Liberation. A. Suleiman. A. Manani. Suleiman.
Another
speech.
What about the class conflicts in the industrial society?
This is a book by Terrell. I want you to get it. This is just a reference book. I just jot it down for you. In case one day you come across it. I just always give you such a kind of evidence in every day. You see, even if you have exposed, I will give you some. So all the end of the course. You understand? I have to give you certain methodology things also, which is missing from last year. So we will throw it out there. So you have to take off. You understand? Because we don't have to give you a paper and you throw it away and you don't read it.
No.
When I give you a note, it changes now. So sociology?
Change.
So now I want you to give me, tell me, just raise your hands, the representatives for the different groups. Raise your hand. Representatives. Not all the groups. Okay, how many we have now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 groups are there. So these are the groups who is going to be given the priority of exposing. So let's start with the Eritrean group. I want you to give us what are the different methodology going to have now, sir. Nobody asking you a question. Tell us about your liberation fronts. So you put the camera on the president. Please. No, she don't. She's okay. No, she don't. She's okay. She's good. She said. So I had this one. Go ahead. Please. Tell us what you're going to do. Yeah, everything. I don't know. What you're going to tell us? It's your responsibility.
Our title is the Liberation Front, the case of Eritrea.
Yes.
And. Our main objective is to know how the Eritrean arms struggle brought about a social change in the Eritrean case. And so to do that, our starting question is how the Eritrean arms struggle brought about a social change. And the hypothesis for that, we hypothesized that by enlightening and effectively organizing the Eritrean people, the APLF or the ALF, the APLF, brought a social change. So the main subject of our research is the genesis of the Liberation Front. And our concept is a Liberation Front, and the conceptual dimensions we are going to see are the 12 characteristics or the 12 parameters of a Liberation Front, and hence we are going to analyze the Eritrean Liberation Front based on the 12 parameters, and we will come to the final.
What are the 12 parameters for the people who don't know?
The 12 parameters are, one is administrative and the other is the national liberation. And the organization must have the vision of an independent state.
Creation of an independent state.
And there must be also an avant-gardism, and there should be also pluriclassist.
It must be a pluriclassist movement. It must be as well, it must be led by a group of avant-gardists and a leading group.
Leadership.
All right, leadership. Go ahead.
And also, it must apply administrative.
It must choose as a motor of change a conflict based on violence. Apply to armed struggle. All right.
Another is it must have an ideology.
Yeah, it must have a clear-cut ideology. So, what was the ideology of the Eritrean Liberation Front? History and rewrote the Eritrean history and liberate the Eritrean.
Yes.
And
also, it must have a different organization.
A different structure of organization. And then it must have a host, an alliance.
An alliance, and it must be conflictual.
It must be conflict, it has chosen as conflict, but an alliance, Eritrean liberation front, whether it has an alliance or not. These are some more or less, the different 12 parameters. Now, tell us, I want you to go to see Southern African Liberation Front. Who is there? Is there anybody representative from Southern African Liberation Front? Okay, now the Guinea-Bissau, Cabral's Liberation Front, you explain. You put the camera on the gentleman, in the light. My friend We call him Rada because of his big ear.
From the life of the Italian man. He's our Italian Breco. See?
He has to get therapy.
Look on the camera. Okay, our topic is the PIG, which means the African Independence for the Guinea-Bissau and the Cape Verde Party. So our subject is the genesis, how the PIG started, led by the Admiral Cabral. He is one of the famous and prominent one of the prominent African struggle leader. So our object is to see how the struggle and the unity strategy brought an independence to the Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde under the colony of Portuguese. We have hypothesized that the cultural resistance plays a major role. In fact, the cultural resistance is one of the ideology, the parameters of the liberation movement. We shall see more in detail during the presentation time. Our concept is liberation movement, as many liberation movement has dimensions, 12 dimensions. Also, we shall see how the 12 dimensions play and how the independence come about. And we have theory to follow is the conflictual theory. Under the oracles of course, we have two books, this one and that one, from Admiral Cabral written, and this one is from the 1980, The Unity and the Struggle, and the other is the book written by Admiral Cabral in 1974. We have also other oracles written by James
Theories.
Just a book titled Portugal in Africa. Because it's Cape Verde and Guinea-Bissau and other, Angola, Mozambique, were under the colony of the Portugal. And our methodology will be on the historical analysis. We shall see how the genesis and how the culture plays, how the involvement of the people, for the people, by the people, for the independence. We shall see this whole thing, and we are really motivated to work with this topic because it deals about the prominent, and Africa is our identity, and we can learn something from Admiral Cabral and the PIG movement. In fact, the power now in the Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde is the PIG, especially in Guinea-Bissau. So this is a struggle for the people, by the people, for the people, and we know that one thing Admiral Cabral said, the most important we are trying to see is when he tries to empower the indigenous people. Wherever evil reigns, there is no place for good. This was addressing to the Portuguese colony and empowering the indigenous people of Guinea-Bissau and Cape Verde. This is, and we are, I am your partner, and Petros belong.
And this guy here.
Thank you.
That one, the man is there.
Macho. Okay. We are on the.
This is a methodological approach to sociology. How do you react to a foreign economy? That's very important. Go ahead.
Our book is about European separatist movement, and our subject or our title is European Separatist Movement, the case of IRA, ETAN, PKK, and Chechnya. And our object is, first we want to show that European separatist movement are weakening from time to time, and our object is why European separatist movement are weakening their strength, and our tentative answer to our starting question is
Because of war weariness and losing of leadership, European separatist movement are weakening from time to time, and our methodology is...
Don't panic, take it easy. You're a good speaker, what happened to you? Go ahead now, come on, talk to us.
Yeah, our methodology is...
The way I'm hearing you, I'm getting to do it, I think. But the other day you were tough, you saved the group. So go ahead.
Come We will take historical analysis, our methodology, and our oracles are Ozak Susan and Bonacri, both are from US.
Yeah. Okay, now.
All about our...
You are in the same group?
Yeah.
Your group is? Okay, amazing. Now go to the group and African is to the lady. He's ahead. Okay, the monk. I'm sorry.
Our title is The Vision of Pan-Africanism. And our subject is, we want to show the illusion of Pan-Africanism. And the object for this is that Pan-Africanism was an illusion. In a question form to put it, did Pan-Africanism bring what it aims to form? Did it bring unification to Africa? We want to show this. We want to say something about this. And the hypothesis for this, or the tentative answer, is Pan-Africanism in fact brings division, not unification. And still now, it's been 50 years from that time that Africa is not still united. So we want to show that the vision of Pan-Africanism was a failure. Even Pan-Africanism kills its own prophets. And the methodology we want to use is a historical analysis method. We want to analyze the history of Pan-Africanism from its beginning till now. How is it going? And now it has become a failure. And the concept is Pan-Africanism. And the oracles are Vincent Backpage Thompson in his book, The African and Unity, The Evolution of Pan-Africanism. And John Henry Clark in his book, The Notes for an African World Revolution, Africa at the Crossroads.
Okay now, Suleiman. Salam. Tell your name first. What you study?
Okay, my name is Salam Abamikash. Our topic is on the liberation movements within the Middle East region, and especially in the case of the Palestinians. Our motivation for taking that topic is one, the Hamas faction and election, which was conducted on January, and the main reason for their coming in power. It's a major contemporary of interesting issue to study. Secondly, to also see the myth of the Western democracy. What the societies are doing is they are imposing democracy in the Middle East, and to some extent this imposition of democracy is facing some problems. So
no, we don't agree that there is a camera in front of you, right? We don't want to study the Western democracy here. We are there to study the Palestinian Liberation Movement. You have even basic claims you said last time,
yeah,
that one man's liberation is one man's?
Yes.
I know Suleiman is a little bit intimidated by the camera. Take it easy, come on now.
But that is in the case of democracy, it has to also be studied, because if we are going to take the liberation movement of the Palestinians, the question of democracy is also side by side taken into that issue. But anyway, our focus, our motivation is...
Now, let's ask you guys, even there is a camera, our question. What is your objective?
Okay, this is our motivation.
You're talking about democracy or Western democracy. It's another thing, my friend. It's a political science class. Now, we're talking about the liberation from conflict. You have said you use one man's conflict. Terrorism is one man's liberation from. So you want to analyze terrorism? Are we going to see all the liberation from that terrorists?
No.
Or the liberation from? Then you have changed it.
No.
Tell us your object.
There is no change.
Okay.
What I'm talking of is our motivation. This is
the negotiation.
Yes.
What is your object?
Okay. Now the subject is
object.
Okay. The object is what is the role of violence application in the process of bringing about.
No, leave the paper.
I want.
Man, I can help you out. Leave that paper down and talk to us. What's your object? What do you want to say?
Okay. What is the role of the violence application in bringing about social change in the Palestinian case?
So what is your hypothesis? What do you want to say? Your answer?
1 month's terrorism is another month's heroism.
Okay. So this contains, you want to see how the West sees the Palestinians, the Western Democrats.
Exactly.
How do they see
the
liberation as a terrorism?
Yeah.
That's what he's saying. I got you. Now, what is your methodology?
The concept is, our conceptual dimension is a revolutionary approach. And our conceptual composites, they are like fanaticism, violence and conflicts, conceptual relativity, absolutism, terrorism, absolutism, sacramentalism, and so on. These are the conceptual composites. And the conceptual indicators, we have various statistical figures and as well qualitative data to
the
discussion to which clarify the question that we are raising. Our theory is based on a more or less conflict paradigm. This conflict paradigm, our oracles are Yona Alexander and John Inglis.
Camera has intimidated you. Camera can intimidate you. You understand? The light is the camera, you can't. That's what I want to say. Suleiman was a kind of intimidated. But he came out and said, now let's check out what Sanai's got together. Come on, this way. It's all right, it's okay. Sanai wants to say. Okay. Sanai, what you got home? What you got cooking? So, right, you know what I'm saying? The time is 12 o'clock, I'm writing. We say in American English, what's burning? What's cooking?
Okay.
To the camera. Please, you can come on this side. Okay, yeah. So you can see her in face. She doesn't like side looking. Yeah. She's photogenic anyway. Oh.
Okay, my name is Sanai Miguel, and I want to study about this.
You are a sociologist?
Yes.
You are graduating soon
in
sociology degree from the University of Asmara. We are watching. I'm sure she got A in the last. A in sociology. Am I right? She's good. Now, come on.
Okay, our topic is the SPLA. The SPLA is the Sudan's People Liberation Movement. Here, what we want to show is the factors that help the SPLA to succeed in its liberation movement. So, our object here is how could the SPLA bring political and economic equality in Sudan? Our hypothesis or our tentative answer to this question is through stressing on the idea that call for a liberation from what rather than a liberation from whom, the SPLA can bring political and economic equality in Sudan. So our concept here is the liberation movement, and we are going to analyze the SPLA based on the 12 characteristics of the liberation movement. And our theory is a conflict theory, and one of our oracles are Khalid Mansour and John Garan in the book The Call for Democracy in Sudan, and Khalid Mansour's book War and Peace in Sudan. And in doing this, we are going to use, or our methodology is historical analysis. Thank you.
Okay. Here you go. The Frenchman now. You turn on the Frenchman, the camera. Put the Frenchman, the camera on the Frenchman. Spotlight on the Frenchman. Camera and spotlight.
I'm not actually photogenic.
You are photogenic. Not photogenic. So now you are photogenic. Now go ahead. Tell us what you want to do.
My name is Yadmai Sbian, and I'm from the Department of Sociology and Social Work. And the title that we are dealing with is that globalization and international inequality. And the object is there is inequality. We want to show that there is inequality with the existence of globalization. And the subject or what we want to show is that globalization plays a great role in bringing or in creating inequality in the third world countries. And the starting question is that to what extent does the phenomenon of globalization brings inequality among the countries of the world? And the tentative answer for that is the more the occurrence of the phenomenon of globalization, the more inequality happens among the countries of the world. And the indicators, I mean the conceptual dimensions that we are to use are the special interest of technology, technological inequality, social inequality, the political, economic, and other inequality because of the existence of globalization. And the composites for the conceptual dimensions are like the resource utilization can be taken, the conflict in using these resources, or the cooperation among countries, as well as the what we call the game means the competition that we see among the countries of the world that would be taken as the conceptual composites, and the composites for the conceptual dimensions. And the theory that we are to use is the world system theory of Immanuel Wallerstein. And it says, I think it tries to categorize the countries of the world in three divisions. One is the core, or countries of the core, the periphery, and the semi-periphery. And mainly what he emphasizes is that the exploitation, means the overall exploitation of the third world countries by the countries of the West, or the European countries. It means that it tries to show that one how Westernization or Europeanization is affecting to the extent of development of the third world countries, either politically it would be, or socially, or it would be in terms of economy and other things. And the oracles that we are to use are one is Loge of 1996. It talks about the cultural invasion and as well as the political ideology that's mainly extending or encroaching into the third world countries so that it dominates the politics of the third world countries. And it also talks about the cultural invasion, on how culturally third world countries are being exploited. So we try
the French man is on the case, man! Thank you! Who is extra? The same.
Okay.
Now, who is going to give his? What's your group? Okay, who else is the next one? South Africa. Who is South Africa? You are? Okay, let's go with him. He just left. One more. Yeah. What's your group? Latin America. The queso? Okay, la revolution. Viva! La revolution.
Okay, my name is Waldo Mogusco from Sociology and Social Work. And our title is Cuban Revolution under Fidel Castro. And we are going, first, our motivation to study this or to take this topic is that why Fidel Castro is in power in such for above 45 years, what makes him in power yet? And our subject is the genesis of the Cuban Revolution or Fidel Castro, and our object is what are the triggering reasons or factors for the revolution, and our object is that the factors or the main factors for the revolution are the hatred or the influence of the American or to the Cuban government. And the other is the stagnation of the economy of the Cuba. And to remove those both main causes, Fidel started the revolution. Our concepts are revolution, socialism, and capitalism. And we will emphasize that how the Cuban revolution included all the 12 parameters or the patterns. And at last, our methodology is that historical analysis, And the, our oracle says, one is this. Cuba. The making of a revolution by Roman Eduardo Cruz. And the other is the interview of Fidel Castro by Lee Loc, the well-known American journalist in 1969. And at last we are going to divide ourselves in different groups. Thank you.
Okay, so let me come to this side. Now here is the brother. What you doing? This is the Southern African Liberation Front. What is the object of your study? Why you study the Southern African Liberation Front? You'd have studied something else.
We want to know how
to change the perspective. We cannot continue the same kind of What is your methodology? Why are you study? What's your motivation? You want to study South Africa?
Yeah, I want to know how the ANC, National African National Congress, could won the struggle in abolition of apartheid.
You want to study how the ANC has won in abolition of apartheid. So are you going to explain to us apartheid also?
Yes. Apartheid is a Russian discrimination against the indigenous people of South Africa by the British conquerors who came.
The British,
no,
the Afrikaners, they went from Holland.
Later,
yes.
People went from Holland.
Yeah, the Afrikaners. Not the British came after.
Yeah.
Don't panic. Now, what's your methodology?
It's historical analysis.
Okay. How many are you in your group?
We are about 60.
What's your role in that group?
I'm organizing the
activities of the introduction part. Chairman. Yes. Of the group. The dynamic. Latif, go to the camera of the Latif. Atif. Atif, what are you doing? What are you representing?
Sudan's Liberation Front, the People's Liberation Front.
What is your role in there?
I'm the organizer of the group and also the data collector. It's alright, yes, I'm
he's the organizer of the group.
Yeah.
And?
Also primary data collector for the content analysis.
But your group is not, their group is not divided according to the 12 parameters.
It's
not you see?
Yeah.
Here. That is. That is. Put a camera on that here.
Times, but the matter is just to organize the data.
What do you choose to do? What do you choose to do? Yeah.
Just from the beginning, I start to organize the whole group and the data, the historical data.
You are the historical part of the process of?
I organize the whole thing and from the beginning in the historical part.
There is a conflict. Tell us who you are.
We, as a group.
No, it's a, you are a student of history.
Yeah.
Tell your name.
I'm Johannes Heide.
Yeah.
From history department, fourth year.
Yeah.
So.
Graduating. You are a graduate student.
This year I will graduate soon.
You are an ex-fighter.
Yeah.
He was an ex-fighter. He fought for his country's independence.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
Sociologically, we have to define him. You understand? We have to situate you. So you are contesting Atif's.
He was already left for his family.
To Karen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because of some his family's case.
Yeah.
But when we make.
It's a social case, you know, family problem.
When we make. when we make.
The distribution of work. He was not there.
He was not
there. So he lost it. He's out of the group.
No.
He's not out.
He was already in the first meeting was taken as his friend.
Yeah.
The portions okay. of the roles.
Now the meeting has changed. There was a change in the meeting.
Yeah.
So what's his role?
After his...
His bibliography or what?
No, universality.
Huh?
Universality.
Universality. Ah, his role is not historical, universality. You accept? It's all right, he said. It's all right.
I have a point.
Hey, he's got a point. Put the camera on his head. Yeah.
First of all, I was not here. I was in the data collection field, the field. For some
reason.
No, not for them.
You went to South Africa.
No.
You went to South Africa.
No.
You went to South Africa.
No. 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 No.
No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No.
No.
No.
The South Africa, as well as taking other subjects for.
Oh,
so I was
we are talking here. About this class.
About so that's why I was not here.
But you accept the university.
Okay,
it's all right. All right. Last one. Yeah. For his references, these are Vegas and tell your name.
Sorry.
Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry. She got one like the cameraman. We have two from sociology, some of the same thing. These are assistant lecturers in our class, but they're learning how to do it. So give her your point of view about the class a little bit. Go ahead.
Well, this class is nice. I really appreciate it, even from last year.
Okay.
Now, I'm learning this course again, which makes me have a wider view. It's nice, except that you're scaring the students very much.
I'm scaring you. Yeah. Okay, now her.
That's nice.
Did you hear her?
I guess we share almost the same comment about the class, but I think this class is more participatory to your classes than our class was. At least they verbally answer everything now. Wow. So I'm really like.
They're jealous. But they are a part of it. These are princesses, we have to help them out. They are helping us out on organizing the class. They help me in the documentation and everything. You understand? They are working also at the same time, helping their services in the Ministry of Labor and Social Works. It will be careful. Now, here is Sam. Sam is, he followed last year our class. He's an anthropologist graduate from the University of? Rhode Island, Providence. Beautiful island on the Atlantic Ocean, in the western coast of the United States of America. He's a brother in diaspora. He came in last year, he followed. He came from the president's office, what is his name? Dr. Tusfai's suggestion to come and follow our class, and he followed our courses this year. So we really appreciate Sam. Tell us something about the class.
Okay, my name is Sam Yassim. I graduated from the United States on anthropology and Afro-American studies. Minor, and I come over here for experience and to do voluntary work. So the class is nice. I mean, I never have any experience in sociology, but I mean, I'm becoming a sociologist in other hands. So it's nice.
All right then. So we have gone now around to check it out. So next week, who is going to volunteer start on Tuesday to expose his paper, who is ready? You don't need to give us a written paper. What we need is that we need it only, you have to have the class expose what you have just said in front of us. Who is the group? We are ready groups. Yes, so we'll be Solomon's group, the group, one man's terrorism is one man's liberation song. On Tuesday, write down now, on Tuesday will be one man's terrorism is one man's liberation force. How terrorism is applied in the liberation of Palestine. It is taken as a terrorist by the ways, but it's taken by liberation by the people of the Palestinians, who has been occupied by the Jewish state since 1967. So the new movement, who Hamas just took over, did not recognize Israel. You understand? So that is the group who's coming out. You give the name of the list. Who is the next? Who is taking Thursday out? Global man. Who? Globalization. So globalization will be taking the next. What's the date? Take the date, by the way. 27th of April will be given to? the Frenchman, with our globalization, the trends of globalization is destroying our daily life, and the resistance by Cuba, by Brazil, and the other group, what do we call them? Globalization is altermodalism. How altermodalists are provoking this. So you have not to forget altermodalism with globalization. This must be the concept. Altermodalism with globalization must be the title. I'm imposing this. Now the next one. Who's taken? Ethereal Liberation Front. The difference is struggle. Produced during the struggle of the last 50 years in the Horn of Africa. The prominent role played by the Ethiopian Liberation Front in the bringing about the destructive state of Eritrea back to existence. That's why we're going to see. We're going to see according to the 12 parameters. Since we have here the ex-fighters, we don't need to invite anybody because we're living it every day here. And the girl who's presenting here, she's a daughter of the struggle. You understand? This is the occasion we're going to learn a lot about ourselves. You understand? So that are great for that. What was the date of that?
May 2nd.
2006 will be come. You are most welcome. Today many students are absent. So they're not beginning. The distribution is definitely today. I cannot change. Continue. What is next? So, Cabra. Amiral Cabra, culture as a factor of social change, factor as a liberation arm. The problem of renovation of one's culture to bring it about a social change, you understand? In the Lisbonian, Cape Verde and Guinea-Bissau, they are now separated after liberation. Guinea-Bissau actually doesn't exist today because of the inherent conflict. Since the days of Cabra, Guinea-Bissau is in a bad situation. There is a coup d'etat, there is a, things going on, nothing is working out, you understand? It's in a bad shape, that's the thing. You understand? They don't let it function anyway as a state. So you see that, you have to not forget the actual situation of giving this up. And the mom, What is your type? Now, the illusion of Pan-Africanism. Since the Berlin Conference, Africa has been divided since 1885. Africa has been divided, shared by the colonial interests. So in 1945, our brothers from diaspora, the Turan struggles men by Du Bois and Garvey against Booker T. Washington and the rest, they came brought about the creation of the Ghana state. You understand? 1945, Manchester meeting. And then the other meeting in Mali Bamako of the Brotherhood, the alliance against the French colony, brought about the existence of Pan-African movement, which was known through this different six conferences we held. But in the end, it was a deception. We found confirming the Berlin Conference, the division of the continent. What do we have in 1963 in Addis Ababa? The different colonial borders were accepted. Even though Ethiopia was a free state, it didn't help out to join, help out, what is his name? Kwame Nkrumah. So we will see the deception of the prophets of, you have to look at this way. We have the prophets of Pan-Africanism. Who are the prophets of Pan-Africanism? Nkrumah?
Nasser,
no, prophet.
Yeah,
the ancient one, The prophets, we have the all these prophets, those two guys who are the historians, the actors of Pan-Africanism, the three actors, we can't forget this. Now, the consequence of Pan-Africanism is what? Organization of African Unity. A curse for Africa, 1963, 97. And then, the conference in Cairo, 1964. So during this explication, you will give us some of the trends what brought about the division of Africa. Because of the definition of Pan-Africanism was what? It's the movement of the people of African descent and diaspora. You understand? It's defined. It says that people of color have a special character. What are the characteristics of this special character? Their history is non-contingent, ahistoric. You say, black people got no history. They are non-contingent, their history is not transmittable. He says they have the special kind of people, he said. You understand? The black people are special. So it's kind of a racist definition, giving history only to black people. Great, the glorious people, he says. The ancient group was. He wrote about the black princes. He defined how the princes and queens of Africa, the heads and the queen are taken in slavery to Jamaica. He said, in 1775, there was how many thousands of blacks in Jamaica, in the plantation? I give you figures. How many big black people died in the deportation? By whom is this referred? By Roger Brasley. He's a French, an Africanist, a French born in France who founded Sao Paulo University in Brazil. You understand? He's an anthropologist. He wrote the cultural anthropology. He wrote the book Trans, Green Trans and Foreign Crazy. It's a beautiful book. You have to read it. He died, Roger Brasley, in 1979. He was incarnated, became an African. He said there is two kinds of cultural factors in Africa. The Yoruba culture was taken back to Brazil and Haiti. The garden, the voodoo. Our history is a voodoo. It didn't get destroyed by the colonial. We found it today in Haiti. And then the Yoruba Kadomble. Reincarnation in Brazil, a carnival in Brazil. You understand? That's our culture. And then the Rasta movement from Abyssinian culture. You understand? The Rasta movement, the revendication of Africa as a Zionist state, as a holy land of the two-man struggle, two-land struggle. You see, Pan-Africanism is dream, it's prospective. It is not a success as a prospective, you know, as a political prospective. That's a historical and cultural perspective. It is there, but it cannot be realized as a social system. The Roman culture, Roman carnival doesn't exist today. But the culture exists. Why does it exist? Because it doesn't have a social system. Pan-Africanism cannot be realized because the states refuse. If there was states like Nkrumah did, accepted the existence of Pan-African state, then it would have not been only a culture. Now it's a culture, Pan-African. Because of the Rasta movement, the Gado place in Brazil, all